This is the center of one of the world's richest countries and one of the most expensive places there. And that raises an ethical issue. I mean, there are people who have the money to buy at these stores and who don't seem to see any kind of moral problem doing that. But what I want to ask is, well, shouldn't they see some sort of moral problem about that? Isn't there a question about what we should be spending our money on? So we're outside Bergdorf Goodman, where they've got a display of Dolce & Gabbana shoes. And it's kind of amusing to me because about 30 years ago, I wrote an article called Famine, Affluence, and Morality, in which I imagined that you're walking past a shallow pond, and as you walk past it, you notice that there's a small child who's fallen into the pond and seems to be in danger of drowning. And you look around to see where the parents are, and there's nobody in sight. You realize that unless you wade into this pond and pull the child out, the child is likely to drown. There's no danger to you because you know the pond is just a shallow one, but you are wearing a nice pair of shoes and they're probably going to get ruined if you wade into that shallow pond. So, of course, when I ask people this, you know, they always say, well, of course, forget about the shoes. You've just got to save the child. That's clear. And then I stop and say, okay, well, I agree with you about that. But for the price of a pair of shoes, if you were to give that to Oxfam or UNICEF or one of those organizations, they could probably save the life of a child, maybe more than one child, in a poor country where children are dying because they can't get basic medical care to treat very basic diseases like diarrhea or whatever else it might be. And that's really one of the reasons why I think it's interesting to be here on Fifth Avenue talking about ethics. Because ethics is about the basic choices that we ought to make in our lives, and one of those choices is how do we spend our money. I started thinking about these issues back in the 1970s when, for one thing, there was the crisis in Bangladesh where there were millions of people who were in danger of starving because of the repression of the Bangladeshis by the Pakistani army at the time. And that made me think about our obligations to help people who were in danger of starvation. Also, around the same time, I happened to meet someone who was a vegetarian who got me asking myself about, am I justified in continuing to eat meat? What is it that gives us the right or that justifies us in treating animals the way they get treated before they end up on our lunch or dinner or whatever it might be? And I read a little bit about factory farming, intensive farms, and the way they confine animals, which was something that was really just getting going at that stage. And I thought that you can't really justify this, that we've just taken for granted the idea that somehow humans have the right to use animals whichever way they want to. And that isn't defensible. The boundary of species is not something that really is so morally significant that it entitles us to take another sentient being who can suffer or feel pain and do as we wish with that sentient being just because we happen to like the taste of its flesh. So these two issues really got me thinking about applied ethics, which at this time, at the beginning of the 1970s, wasn't really a field. It wasn't really something that philosophers thought was properly philosophy. But I think it was a good time to start thinking about these issues because of the student movement, the radical movement of the 60s and early 70s, which had created a bit more interest in these issues and raised the question, can we make our academic studies more relevant to the important questions of the day? when you do applied ethics, you often find that thinking things through leads you to challenge common sense morality. And of course, this is consistent with a very ancient philosophical tradition. It's exactly what happened with Socrates. When he started asking people about what is justice, they thought they knew what justice is, and then they started thinking about it and they realized they didn't understand it. And of course, Socrates ended up having been forced to drink the hemlock because he was accused of corrupting the morals of the youth. Now, fortunately, that doesn't happen to philosophers today, but it could well be said that, you know, from a conservative point of view, applied ethics does corrupt morals, or not corrupt is the wrong word, but it certainly challenges morals and might lead us to think differently about some things that we have held very dear for a long time. A lot of people think that you can only have ethical standards if in some way you're religious, you believe that there's a God who handed down some commandments or inspired some scriptures which tell you what to do. I don't believe in any of that. I think ethics has to come from ourselves, but that doesn't mean that it's totally subjective. That doesn't mean that you can think whatever you like about what's right or wrong. When you start to look at issues ethically, you have to do more than just think about your own interests. You have to ask yourself, how do I take into account the interests of others? What would I choose if I were to be in their position rather than my position? One of the most obvious things that emerges when you put yourself in the position of others is the priority of reducing or preventing suffering. Because ethics is not just about what I actually do and the impact of that, but it's also about what I omit to do, what I decide not to do. And that's why questions about, you know, given that we all have a limited amount of money, questions about what you spend your money on are also questions about what you don't spend your money on or what you don't use your money to achieve. And a lot of people, I think, forget that. They just say, oh, well, you know, I'm not harming anyone if I go and spend $1,000 on a new suit. In fact, given the opportunities that we have to help and given the way the world is, I think that, you know, quite often you actually are failing to benefit someone, which you could be doing. I think we have moral obligations to help, just as we have moral obligations not to harm. Thousands of years of history and development of philosophy, a lot of philosophers have asked, does life have a meaning? What is it? And that's a question to which I think we can give an answer. And I think the answer is, we make our lives most meaningful when we connect ourselves with some really important causes or issues, and we contribute to that so that we feel that because we lived, something has gone a little better than it would have otherwise. We've contributed in however small a way to making the world a better place. And I think it's hard to find anything more meaningful than doing that, than reducing the amount of unnecessary pain and suffering that there's been on this world, or making the world a little bit better for all of the beings who are sharing it with us.